A lot of people wonder what kind of tech is used within Google, and the answer is there's a lot of tech, but I'll be focusing on the tech stack that I personally use at Google as a software engineer, and some of the answers are definitely going to surprise you. So when I first joined Google last year, I actually joined a front-end team, so I was expecting to do mostly front-end work, but some people ended up leaving, so I actually got put on some back-end projects. And even the next project I'm going to be working on shortly is also a back-end one. Now, since there are a lot of internal tools and frameworks that we use at Google, I'm only going to be really focusing on the open source stuff that we use. So let me start with the front-end tools that I've used so far. First of all, Angular, which probably doesn't come as a surprise because Angular is an open source framework. It's pretty famous. It's not quite as popular as some of the other frameworks, but I think it's well known and it's known for being Google's framework, whereas React.js is Facebook's framework. And typically with Angular, people use TypeScript. That's also what I'm using. It's, I think, the default for Angular projects. But I will say that while Angular is pretty popular within Google, it's actually not the only front-end framework. There's a ton of other front-end frameworks. And if you're not a fan of Angular, like if you think it's overcomplicated or it's kind of weird the way that it does certain things, let me just say that there's an internal framework that you would probably hate even more than Angular. There's also some internal frameworks that I've heard good things about, but there are some that are just horrible. I mean, people really, really hate some of the internal front-end frameworks. Now, like I said, I haven't actually done a lot of front-end stuff at Google so far, but I'm mostly a fan of Angular. I mean, it does overcomplicate some things. I've used React before, so I think Angular definitely has a steeper learning curve, but it's really not that bad. I mean, we have some pretty big projects within Google that use Angular, and I think the thing I like about Angular is if you've worked in one really big project, it's pretty easy to look at another big project because Angular has like a certain way of doing things that's consistent across projects. So it's pretty easy to get familiar with a code base. Compared to React, where you kind of get to make your own design decisions, and that can kind of make projects really inconsistent. And that's pretty much it for front end. Now, moving on to back end, this one's gonna surprise you. We actually use GraphQL. If you're not familiar with GraphQL, it's kind of an alternative to REST APIs. With REST APIs, you have a bunch of endpoints to get stuff to read, stuff to write, and to do all kinds of operations on your API. With GraphQL, you have like a single endpoint. And it's supposed to be really flexible. Within that single endpoint, there could be multiple API calls happening in the background. And you use that single endpoint to actually query things. So it's super flexible. You can prevent like overfetching data that you don't necessarily need. You can make multiple API calls under the hood using just a single query. So it's grown to be a pretty popular tool. Now, the interesting thing about it is that it's actually a tool that was developed at Facebook. While it's open source now, it was a tool that's developed at Facebook, just like React. Now, you wouldn't really be expecting Google to be using a tool of one of its big competitors, but that is the case. I mean, Google is pretty pragmatic. GraphQL is a good tool. It definitely solves a lot of problems that it tries to solve. So why not use it at Google? I'm sure we could implement our own version of GraphQL, but there really isn't a need to do that. So I'm definitely a fan of GraphQL. I mean, I've actually worked with it a tiny, tiny bit, so I don't have a ton of strong opinions on it. But moving on to the language that I've probably used the most so far at Google, it's actually Java, which is probably going to come as a surprise to a lot of you because we use Python on the channel. I definitely think Python is a lot better for coding interviews and data searches and algorithms. But for building an actual backend microservice, I would probably prefer using Java over Python, even though I've said a lot of bad things about Java before. A tool is just a tool. If it solves the problem that you're trying to solve, then it's worth using. Java isn't my favorite language. It's definitely got a lot of boilerplate, but I had a pretty decent experience. I mainly used Java to create a microservice. It was a pretty small microservice, but it was one that I had to create from scratch by myself and pretty much did all the implementation. Now, the framework that I used, I can't really talk about that. It's an internal framework, but the frameworks at Google really do most of the heavy lifting. There's a ton of internal stuff that it doesn't really feel like I'm even coding in Java. It really feels like I'm doing like a Google specific thing. You know, we got all kinds of like dependency injection. Now, one thing I can talk about is Juice. Juice is open source. It was a dependency injection framework created at Google. And that's like one of the things that is used. And there's a ton of other things. And by the way, on the backend side at Google, everything is based on RPCs and protocol buffers. You might have heard of gRPC. The main benefit of using RPC and protocol buffers is that you're sending a smaller package of data. Like the payload is usually going to be a little bit smaller with protocol buffers, which is like a data format, which is different from something like JSON, which is more common, is that you can send the same data in a smaller format. That makes sending data over a network a little bit faster compared to JSON. There's a ton of other things to know about RPCs and protocol buffers, which so far I haven't really had to learn because there's a lot of tools at Google that can actually abstract like 90% of the knowledge. And next is C++, which I actually haven't really used a lot yet, but it's gonna be my next project that I'm working on. And this is also gonna be for a backend microservice. So I really got played when they told me I was gonna be a front-end developer. I think I don't really have a strong preference when it comes to front-end or back-end. I just like understanding how like a system works, how like a framework works and stuff like that. So I'm pretty happy that I've gotten a chance to work on some backend projects. And this next C++ one that I'm gonna be working on is pretty exciting. So I'm looking forward to that. Wish I could talk more about it, but that's okay. And lastly, there are a ton of internal tools for things that you wouldn't even expect. I mean, we have like logging, monitoring, and alerting, pretty much all internal tools that are used for that. But even like simple things like version control, we use an internal tool for that. For our IDEs, our dev environments, our build tools, our release tools, we use pretty much exclusively internal frameworks. I mean, even our IDEs, I guess technically people can use open source ones, like some people use IntelliJ and stuff like that, but like I think 90% of people use an internal IDE. And in fairness, a lot of the tools at Google, they just make the experience so easy. And things really just work very well. Like the process of making some local changes and then creating a pull request and then having that get reviewed and all that, like it's so simple at Google. And that's something I really, really love. So yeah, these are the tools that I've used so far at Google. This is the tech stack, in case you were wondering. Let me know what you think. Were you surprised by any of this? I'm sure the GraphQL was surprising for you. And let me know what kind of tech stack you use at your job and whether you like it or dislike it. If you're preparing for coding interviews, I highly recommend checking out neatcode.io. It's a free site I created, and I definitely think you're missing out if you're not using it as a part of your preparation process. I released a bunch of new features recently, most notably being able to log in and log out to save your progress. So I really hope people find that helpful. If you enjoyed, don't forget to like and subscribe. It really supports the channel a lot. Thank you so much for watching, and hopefully I'll see you pretty soon.